So, hello, there's a warning, yeah. Viewer's discretion, obviously, because we were going to be talking about them other movies, yeah. And some of them are not a double R movie, but they are a R movie, okay. So, I'd like to move on from our previous episode. I was actually, caught using my mobile phone in the cinema. Well, obviously, I want to know what this movie is about. Obviously, it's called Promising Young Woman, but I wanted to know what was going on. And obviously, we're on this certain scene. So, yeah, I've wound it a little bit back because obviously we've got that technology, haven't I? Because, obviously, back in all my heydays, we didn't have these such devices back in our days, right? That you could put your phone on. Because I have been into cinemas a few times and I've seen parents, you know, watching kids' films. And they're watching things on their phone and all that lot. But even old people might go on the internet and all that lot. But once upon a time, when I was a little kiddy winky, there was no such thing as high-tech equipment to even deceive the existence of the internet. And I couldn't get any information back then like you can now with your phones and all that lot. Now, the only way you could find information was on the telly. Now, no one didn't have loads of tellies all over the room. There would just be one telly, and that would be all for your parents. And the usual time they used to put me in front of their TV was about definitely around dinner time, when your mum might be making dinner for your dad or whatever, or the milkman and that. But there was these educational programs to educating us as little kiddie winkies with like movies and stuff and all that lot. And I'm talking about the classic good old Rainbow series. They always came out with good information, and they would have told me the information about Promising Young Woman is quite a very scary movie. It's like Deliverance, like for men. That's definitely reminding me of that scene in Rainbow, that.
What do you mean by Rainbow?
Well, you remember 1984 when Angel Thornton, right, was smuggling all that deadly powdered form of dry food for bears?
Bears? What?
Why are you on about? Well, you know, that bear movie. Oh, that movie, yes. Well, you know, it reminds me of Rainbow. Why Rainbow? Well, you remember that inappropriate episode, with Bungle, the bear, right? Because there's that episode, just get on with it. Well, it's inappropriate. It was educational on that. But we had that episode that, Bungle, he's been exposed to that white powder, and he was completely different. When, you remember, Rod, Jane and Freddy, Jane, plain Jane, cocaine brain, right, Jane, yeah. Yeah, we all remember Jane, yes, because of Rod, Jane and Freddy, isn't it? Yeah, that's right, yeah. Well, Bungle did appropriate things to Jane, didn't he, when she was on her own with him, right? Oh, is that the episode where you tell you not to do appropriate touching? Exactly.
That was for kids, everyone, wasn't it?
Yes. That reminds me of that episode of Rainbow when Jane was teaching us kiddie winkies how to suck white liquid. What are you on about? You know, that liquid, Oh, that at school. Yeah. We used to get free milk and all that lot, didn't we? Well, yeah. Well, why are you getting up with this? Well, you know that famous director, well, I can't think of his name just right, Mama, but there's that film about milk, isn't there? You know, that famous movie, you know, right at the beginning, you know, about teenagers drinking milk at a certain bar. What are you on about? Well, I think it's called Clockwork Orange. That's the one. Yeah, yeah, right. But what director are you on
about?
Yeah,
well, excuse me. I would like to get back to the movie where I want to see what's going to happen.
Well, yes, we will. But we're having the discussion. Yeah, that's what he wanted me to do. That's why he's had me come and see this movie, right? So, yeah, that famous director, right?
What? What do you mean, famous director?
Don't be interrupting, Captain Gorgeous. What? Yeah, but which one? It was our generation, this director. Oh, right. Oh, the most very famous one, then.
Who's that, then?
Oh, come on. You must have seen some of his movies. Yeah, but... just don't hang around. What's his name? Because I'm trying to think. It's tipping my tongue back. It's a bit awkward. Oh, yeah, because he didn't like this film or he's scared of this film. Oh, I'll put an interview on or something. Oh, see, he's got to take over again, hasn't he, Captain Gorgeous?
Oh, I'm never going to get a chance to see this movie, am I?
Clockwork Orange was, I think, the first punk rock movie ever made, and you know, it was a very bleak vision of a dangerous future where young people, teenagers, are free to roam the streets without any kind of parental, you know, exception, and they break into homes and they assault and rape people, and it was that the subject matter was dangerous, but Kubrick had a kind of twinkle in his eye, especially the scene where you hear Gene Kelly singing in the rain, when he's basically kicking a man practically to death. And that was one of the most horrifying things I think I've ever witnessed. Just a counterpoint of the music and the song and kicking him every time the music commanded it. And that was audacious and I think very dangerous in its time.
And when you put on Singing in the Rain during that sequence where he's kicking that person to death, it is utterly contemptuous, and it is almost like saying, why isn't somebody doing something about this? Where is the world when these acts of men against men are happening all over the world, you know, every 30 seconds? You know, where's justice? Where's order? You know, why do we allow this chaos to happen? Of course, the great morality play that is Clockwork Orange is.
But when you look at the movie right now, unfortunately, history is caught up to the movie. And the headlines we now live with every day in our lives are not dissimilar to some of the subject matter of the 1960s film Clockwork Orange.
Clockwork Orange. Clockwork Orange is a depiction of grotesque violence, but it also has utter contempt for violence. But after all of this, you know, deprogramming and a kind of proselytizing of the Malcolm McDowell character through science and theory, he comes out the other end more charming, more witty, and with such a devilish wink and blink at the audience that I am completely certain that when he gets out of that hospital, he's going to kill his mother and his father and his partners and his friends, and he's going to be worse than he was when he went in. And so in a sense, I've always felt that Clockwork Orange was Stanley's most defeatist movie. The film where he appears to totally give up on society. And the film that maybe justifies why he lives in St. Albans in the safety of the British countryside. Because he was afraid of that.
No, that's not him. That's Steven Spielberg, isn't it? Or whatever. He's famous, but... No, this is a generation when we were getting older and all that lot. I ain't got a bleeding clue now.
I ain't got a bleeding clue what this movie's about. It's something to do with promising young woman, is it?
Well, it's an R movie.
Right.
Not a double R movie, but it's an R movie, right? The first R, right?
Right, Well, what, isn't that irrelevant? I don't know what this movie is about, so why are you talking about this movie?
Yeah, I think best thing is put the trailer on for him. Yeah, that's a good idea. Well, I want to watch the movie!
There was me, that is Alex, and my three droogs, that is Pete, Georgie, and Dim. And we sat in the Corova milk bar, trying to make up our Razudox what to do with the evening. The Corova milk bar sold milk plus, which is what we were drinking. This would sharpen you up and make you ready for a bit of the old ultra-violence.
The evening's a great time, isn't it, Alex Barney?
He's enterprising, aggressive, young, bold, vicious. He'll do.
Who on earth could that be?
Now it was lovely music that came to my aid, a bit of the old Ludwig van.
Little brother, did he
well?
It'll be your own torture. I hope to God it'll torture you to madness.
Gorgeousness and gorgeosity made flesh.
So what was the point of that showing me that trailer?
Well, obviously, they're dealing with white-padded milk, aren't they, right?
Right.
Now, we all know that guy, he, Red Mist dude, right, he's put his ends down there, and I think he's realised that she might be strapped up.
You mean like she's wearing a gun or something?
No, a bit like in a Clockwork Orange. You know, they've got them detective cricket things they have on.
Right. Oh,
you mean a jock strap? Yeah. She's got one of them on, but a lady's one. What's a lady's one? I don't think they do they? No, but my teacher taught me about these, these lady ones, right? Your teacher? Well, yeah, he'll stand off there. My teacher wanted us to collect jumble for our jumble sale. And, she mentioned, if they like things what get old, like, cuddly toys and that, and they smell a bit funky. And, I went to my mum's bedroom and she has this drawer that says mum's toys. And then I opened it up and they stank. And also, I gathered all their toys up, look all pretty in there. And I took them to school, right? But my school teacher said to me that it was inappropriate what I brought in for the jumbo. So what happened? Well, she rang my mum, and my mum wasn't happy about what happened, and obviously, she didn't like other people touching her things. She said it was unhygienic and all that lot. So what did you bring? Well, the teacher explained that I brought my mum's strap on, right?
Right, what for?
Well, for jumbo. Yeah, I gathered that, but do you know what it was? Well, I was a child, wasn't I? I mean, I was watching Rainbow back in the days, and they didn't explain anything like that, did they, in them days?
Right, but why are you going with this?
Well, see, I think she might be wearing one of them.
What do you mean by wearing one of them?
Well, she freaked out when she said Neil before Zod or something.
No, she didn't. I mean, she did say his name.
Yeah, but it's Red's name, his name's Red Mist, isn't it?
No, I'm not saying the other one.
No, that's another film. Well, I ain't saying that anyway.
look, move on, right? Because you're making it all complicated. Can we carry on watching the film? I want to see a bit more, please.
Hey, Neil, yeah? Is that I need to go home?
Wait on, I've already seen this bit. Yeah, I know. I just want to know what she actually said. See, I told you she said Neil. All right, fair enough, Clebby Clogs. Yeah, well, you're not that clever, are you? You can't even remember that director's name, can you? Well, it's that famous one. Oh, we're not back on this director again, are we? Well, he doesn't know who he's on about yet, does he? I mean, any films coming to mind? Well, yeah, he's done a few famous films, a lot, but you know, not as much as, you know, Steven, like, but yeah, you know. I know it's not Steven, right, because he created them PG-13, didn't he, because he had done kids films, but very scary kids films in the 80s and that, but, you know, he was directing back in the days, and you know, in 70s, wasn't he, when he did them TV movies as well, you know, like Duo and that, because obviously I'm Petrohead, but it's definitely not him, right? I do know that, right? But I know this director did talk about Clockwork Orange. Well, why don't you look on your phone and find out who it is? You just told him not to go on his phone! Well, yeah, but now he's got me curious about this director! I've already seen this bit! Yeah, I'm building the tension up, Rock, because it's really scary, isn't it? Well, yeah, but why did it back again? Because, obviously, he wants us to go and talk about certain stuff. What do you mean, he? Well, you know, because you know that famous director, I can't remember his name yet, just yet, right? Right, not Steven Spielberg. We all think of that when we think of the famous directors, don't we? Yeah, it's the other one, right? Well, we can go through a massive list of directors. Just name one movie. I can name the movie what he talks about. Well, what movie is that? Well, he talks about Clockwork Orange, right? And he's on about Stanley Kubrick, right? As who? What, Stanley? You do know I've got a speech impediment, or what? And I'm not good, you know, I can't help it, right? But yeah, right. He talks about this director, what did Clockwork Orange, and you know he took the movie away because obviously, you know, it started violence, and especially the topic about it as well. That what makes it interesting about this, the director, what did this movie?
What are you rambling on about now? Can you see a bit more of the movie?
Why did you say that?
I've already seen this bit.
I know you have, but the thing is, it's reminding me of another movie. Anyhow, it's reminding me about this interview, what I'm trying to find now. Now, I will admit that, Captain Know-It-All, that I actually do know that he's talking about Clockwork Orange, but he's not talking about Clockwork Orange as the subject. He's talking about the other film, right? The other thing we talked about in part 5. You mean Straw Dogs? Yeah, that's the one, yeah. But this director's talking about, Clockwork Orange.
Alright, so that explains why I couldn't find it then. That's why I ended up with Steven Spielberg, isn't it? When he was doing about Clockwork Orange. So, this director's talking about another movie.
Yeah, Straw Dogs, but it brings up Clockwork Orange.
Alright, oh, that'll narrow it down a bit more, won't it?
I think I found it. This is it, I think.
So I have a revival review of Straw Dogs that was in the LA Reader from February 1983, back when Straw Dogs was playing at the New Beverly. And it's from Dave Kerr and Straw Dogs. Released the same year as Stanley Kubrick's A Clockwork Orange, the Sam Peckinpah film touched off innumerable debates about violence in the movies. But the difference between Kubrick and Peckinpah is a difference between impersonal sadism and an individual morality strongly expressed. Though doubtlessly reactionary, Straw Dogs has the heat of personal commitment and the authority of deep, if bitter, contemplation. It's also movie-making of a high order. Dustin Hoffman's performance as the weak mathematician goaded into violence is still his best.
I mean, I take a little umbrage at him saying Clockwork Orange is about impersonal sadism. It's a treatise on you know, the value of choice.
I actually understand exactly what he means, and I can actually say
it was, people were very
slag
on Kubrick for being impersonal and cold.
Well, I still think he's making a strong case, because I mean, if you're talking about the case he's making, I think he's talking about the violent sequences inside of it. And yeah, Beckinpah is wrestling with the morality that Kubrick is not. Kubrick's trying to creep us out. And then he has a larger political allegory attached at the end of it. But that's really kind of highfalutin. I'm not saying anything bad about it. I like Clockwork Orange.
No, I know. I just think it's less... he does make a political allegory. He does talk about the politics of it. But what he's really talking about is be able to have choice.
But it suggests that it's not personal. It's a high-flown thesis on the subject of personal choice. One of my negatives about the film, and I would actually include this in a lot of Peckinpah's films, where it's there's some directors that have an alliance with the composer, and their alliance with the composer takes them to new heights,
mm-hmm.
and takes them to heights that they can never go to on their own. And those are,
I gather that was the right clip then. Yeah, that's the director. So you don't know who he is then, talking about Clockwork Orange. Yeah, well, Dave, it's one of them names that I can't get, you know, top of my head and that. Don't make excuses, you don't know, do you? Well, I'm trying my best to think of the name. Well, it's Quentin Tarantino. You know, I mean, obviously, when you say famous directors, we all jump at Steven Spielberg, but yeah, Quentin Tarantino is one of them as well.
Who the hell is that?
Oh, bleeding heck. So, to answer your question, Captain Gorgeous, he is a famous director. And I can help you by showing some clips.
What for?
And then David finally... Roger's first movie, The Worm Turns.
Yeah.
All right. The Worm Turns. And it's really interesting. He truly becomes the man he hadn't been through the whole movie, because he's defending his house, he's defending his home, he's defending his home. So he says, I will not let violence be committed against this house.
Yeah, I live in this house.
I will not let violence be committed against it. And and then all of a sudden David has just shows that, oh wow, this brainy guy actually has some ingenuity when it comes to this. But one of the things, and I don't want to go through a blow by blow because that'll ruin the film, but the thing that's so, I think, truly fantastic about this ending is, again, they never turn into the giggling goofballs that, you know, go in and rape and murder Charles Bronson's wife and daughter in Death Wish. They're just throwing rocks, and it's just, it's one of those weird things where it's like, okay.
What is the point of you doing that?
Well, it reminds me of that scene what you're trying to get to watch.
Well, we're all trying to watch, but yeah.
Well, it reminds me of that bit what Quentin Tarantino said. What bit? Well, you know about Death Wish? You know, Charles Bronson and that? Right, what, I'm confused again. Well, it reminds me of a trailer of, what, Death Wish?
What is Death Wish?
Oh, I'll put a trailer on for you and you'll know.
Why?
Enjoy a typical afternoon in New York City.
Groceries, man.
Hey, mother.
My name is Paul Kersey, young man. I'm sorry. She died a few minutes ago, Mr. Kersey.
Any chance of catching these men?
There's a chance, sure.
Just a chance.
I'd be less than honest if I gave you more hope, Mr. Kersey.
This is Paul Kersey. This is the story of a man who decided to clean up the most violent town in the world.
I said, turn around. Give me the money.
He begins where all the super cops leave off.
Bugging has gone down by how much, sir?
$9.50 a week to $4.70, he reported last week.
You understand not so many people know that.
And you want to keep it that way, huh?
Oh, no, we have to keep it that way, Inspector. This whole city would explode.
And if this prison is listening to my voice, I urge him in the name of law and order to desist from this one-man crusade and turn himself into the police.
Let's see the money, man.
Call him a mad vigilante. Call him a hero. Either way, he's always on target.
We want you to get out of New York permanently.
Never make a death wish, because a death wish always comes true, and you get to love it.
I don't understand why that's got to do with anything me promising young woman.
It does, what? Pay attention to what I'm going to show you with promising young woman.
That's what I've been trying to do.
I just thought
that
you were drunk. Yeah, very drunk.
Look, I've already seen this bit.
Yeah, but you ain't seen the trailer, have you, of Death Wish 2 now, have you?
What?
It happened once before.
Some muggers followed my wife and daughter home from the market.
It's about to happen again.
The police there got a very good description of the muggers too. But it didn't do any good.
We do what we can. And so does he.
Is this your daughter, Mr. Kersey? Mr. Kersey.
When murder and rape are the crimes, Bronson is the only punishment. Charles Bronson, Death Wish 2.
There's something else you should know, sir. Paul Kersey now lives in Los Angeles.
Oh, my God.
Now you tell me there's a vigilante out there.
Do you believe in Jesus?
Yes, you do. Yeah, you're going to meet him.
He killed 9 people in New York City 4 years ago. The people he killed were mothers. He became a hero.
What did he look like?
He was a very good citizen, that's what he was. That guy saved our lives, dammit. Where the hell were you guys, giving out parking tickets?
When violence rules the city, when the police can't stop it, one man will, his way.
Watch out!
Charles Bronson.
Goodbye.
Death Wish 2. He's doing it for you.
I don't understand. Why are you doing this with these trailers? I don't know what Death Wish is.
Well, yeah, but you're getting that vibe though, aren't you?
What vibe?
Well, carry on paying attention to promising young woman.
That's what I've been trying to do.
Yeah, well, I'm not. But that's good, isn't it? I think you should leave.
Will you leave it alone? Because all you're doing is messing about saying the same bit. I've already seen that bit. I don't know what's going to happen.
Well, yeah, but I'm getting the vibe up because I don't know. That it reminds me of Death Wish. It's got to be like the third one.
A city pushed to the edge. People pushed to their limit, and no one's got much guts to stop them.
It's election time!
Charlie Hillers.
Yes!
4 weeks.
9 acts of random violence. This isn't a neighborhood.
It's a war.
But there is one way. One man who won't be pushed. Charles Bronson.
What's the problem?
How are you going to die?
It'll be just like before, Mr. Vigilante. There's one important difference. You're going to work for me.
People have got to start to fight back and hard.
I sent him a message.
That's him.
I'll take care of him.
And now, he's in the middle of a war.
See what you've done? You got me mad.
In a world gone mad, there is only one law. His. Charles Bronson. Death Wish 3. Bronson's back in New York. Bringing justice to the streets. Charles Bronson. Death Wish 3.
I still don't understand why you're putting these weird trailers on for.
Well, it's to get the vibe up for you, right? Because that's what some people might get that impression of.
No, I don't know what you're doing, but you seem to be just winding him up now, because he wants to know what's going to happen.
Well, obviously you know what happens, and I've only got technical, might be a bit information what happens.
Oh, because you were looking at your phone?
Yeah, but you're left with your imagination, right? You don't know what's going to happen. That's what I'm getting at. Because, you know, like Quentin Tarantino, like I've mentioned, right, with them interviews. Yes. Well, they're having a right good conversation about the vibe of the movie and explaining about the movie. And that's what I thought that Captain Know-It-All wanted me for. Not to embarrass me or anything, was it?
Well, no, but getting into a bit debate, yeah, and stuff, yeah, it's very interesting.
Well, it'd be interesting if I can carry on watching the movie.
Well, a little bit more for you.
Why a little bit?
Oh, I'm
still seeing the same bit we've already seen.
I'm building the expense up, that's what I'm doing.
But I don't understand why you're building this expense up. I just want to carry on watching the movie.
I am, but you need to be aware of Death Wish 4, aren't you?
There's a fourth one?
Yeah, it's a trailer.
No!
Two kids looking for a new thrill.
Just like I promised.
Yeah, sure.
But this time the thrill went too far. Crack has claimed another victim. Dealers are making up their own rules, and no one is able to stop them. Somebody has got to crack down.
Who are you?
Death.
Charles Bronson in the biggest Death Wish ever.
It has to be stopped, cousin.
Death Wish 4, The Crackdown.
Spent a small fortune buying information on the major drug dealers in Los Angeles.
I'll handle this my own way, no interference from you.
He's working to destroy the drug empire.
It's either him or us.
Now, Bronson is their target. The trap is set.
Here he comes.
The fuse is lit. Bronson is unleashed. Charles Bronson, Death Wish 4, The Crackdown.
What is the purpose of you showing me these trailers?
Well, the purpose is actually to have that discussion time, because obviously we might be talking about what we are actually thinking about what's going to happen in the movie. Obviously me and you haven't seen the movie, but Mr. Captain Know-It-All knows, doesn't he?
Yes, and it would be quite interesting, but I don't understand the purpose of Death Wish movies.
Well, Quentin Tarantino
brought the subject up for stray dogs, didn't he? Well, yeah. Well, the point is, I get that vibe, maybe, that, you know, not Charles Bronson as such, but, you know, Carey Mulligan could be like that. What do you mean?
I'm really fucking high right now.
Oh, will you carry on?
No, we got to discuss bits about it, though, don't we?
Well, why?
I want to know what you're thinking about what you think's going to happen.
Well, I could ask you.
Well, obviously, I'm thinking of Death Wish.
Oh, no!
In the world of glamour and high fashion, a new crime syndicate is taking over.
Kickaboo.
I watched this guy come up through Irish gangs and I was ruthless.
He's infiltrated every aspect of my business.
Their methods are brutal.
Promise me if anything should happen to me, he'll take care of Chelsea.
Gone. The one thing they didn't count on was an enemy who wouldn't back down.
You know, these people, they steal, they murder, destroy people's lives, they get away with it.
Percy's no amateur. You've got a problem. Charles Bronson is back.
I'm coming for you, O'Shea.
And this time, he's not leaving until his wish is their command.
No judge, no jury, no appeal, and no deals.
But the cops take these guys down. Sometimes the law works.
And sometimes it doesn't.
It's showtime.
This is very...
Where's the girl?
Charles Bronson.
Guns make you nervous?
Death Wish.
I don't actually understand why you're putting these trailers on, because I haven't got a foggies what this Death Wish is about.
Well, obviously you've seen all the trailers near enough.
What do you mean near enough?
Yeah, that's it now. Oh no, there's more.
Since when?
You won't know, will ya? You haven't even seen them, have ya? Yeah, but since when? I don't even know that. Well, you know, Death Wish 6, isn't that? Oh no, they did a sixth one!
Oh no!
Well, a trailer of it. Death Wish. It's a film about, based on a true facts, where a guy and his wife, and they live in New York, and New York's horrible and violent, and something happens to his wife, she dies, and he wants revenge. And his friend gives him a firearm because he is the one and only Charles Bronson. And he goes out killing muggers for fun. And because he's Charles Bronson. And yes, Charles Bronson's daughter, she's in hospital because something happened to her as well when her mum was murdered, and Charles Bronson visits her, but he still wants to go out and play with that gun his friend gave him so he can kill more muggers in New York because he's the one and only Charles Bronson. But the police don't like it because Charles Bronson is having all the fun. So the police officer comes and tells him he's better go away from New York and don't come back because he's a naughty boy. So Charles Bronson goes to the sequel of Charles Bronson Death Wish 2. Not one, but 2.
but it's just like the first one. Said it's just a little bit different because it's filmed somewhere else, LA. But the problem doesn't go away. It's just the same as before. His daughter has an incident again, and actually in this one he has his real wife, and the difference is it must be cold in LA because he wears a woolly bully little hat on his head and has a different gun to shoot everyone because he's the only one. It's Ted Blunston. So we've got to move on to the third one. What's just like the first one and the second one. But that one is a lot different because it might be New York, but it was filmed in England, and you could tell. But who gives a hell? Because what about the bleeding fourth one? Yeah, the big one, the crackdown one. Bigger than even the fifth one. But the fifth one, what the hell was that one? But yeah, we're moving on with the next one. The one and only, the big and only, yeah, with Chaz Bunsen in Death Wish 6. And you won't believe what happens in this one. It's nothing like the first one. Well, near enough, it's not like the first one, but near enough to the second one. But yeah, it's just the same. But this time his new wife and his daughter, this time they go on live on GTA 6. And you can guess what's gonna happen when his wife and his daughter play online. Yeah, some horrible teenagers or little kids kill them. So Chaz Bronson's gotta go online and sort them all out on GTA 6. And who said it was a little kid's game after all? But Chaz Bronson didn't like the story mode of GTA 6 because you start off in prison and you don't start off with a gun.
That wasn't even a proper trailer, that.
Yeah, it was. I saw it on YouTube. Yeah, but you get any type of videos on YouTube. Yeah, but, yeah, Death Wish 6.
So they ain't a Death Wish 6, then.
Well, not like that, ain't it? Even mentioned GTA game, didn't it? There's GTA 6, we know that.
Yeah, so, you know, obviously there must be a Death Wish 6, because that's what I'll get the vibe when you play on the game. You're like Charles Branson killing bad guys or whatever, like this lady's doing, maybe, because I haven't found out yet.
Oh, give up. Will you just play more promising young woman now?
Well, yeah, alright.
I think you should go.
For the second ago, you were determined for me to stay.
You're determined to stay on this subject, aren't you?
Well, yeah, it's a very interesting point now. I mean, it's very tense, isn't it? It reminds me of that YouTube video.
What video? Well, what's the movie?
I'm getting with the subject here.
Just let him do it.
This movie is well scary for anybody out there. Yeah, the one and only, yeah, promising young woman, starring Carrie Mulligan as Cassie, no-nonsense woman. It doesn't matter if a guy has got big balls, she doesn't care. She will give him a stare, and if that doesn't work, she'll give him a good telling off without saying anything, because she's Carrie Mulligan. Yeah, a one-person army what doesn't take no nonsense at all. So, don't be scared. Just go and watch this movie, or else Carrie Mulligan might be coming round to give you a visit soon.
See, that's building a great big vibe about that movie right now, watching that YouTube video. But what are you getting at? Well, what I'm trying to get at is back at that, I'm thinking about my childhood there when I was watching Rainbow. And you always remember that Rainbow used to always tell us about, you know, what your parents might be watching, you know, with the late night weekend movie, right? And I remember always Zippy explaining about, you know, straw dogs. And that sort of gives you a different perspective on the movie. I don't get you.
Can we still get back to the movie?
No, I've got a good point here, right?
But why are you on about Rainbow for?
Because I am.
But why?
Because Rainbow was quite very educational for us kids, especially when they had that episode about a false perspective, right? Where you may think that a movie is on about something and it could be completely different, and it's like that.
What are you on about?
He is sort of right about what Rainbow did.
But Rainbow, why are you on about Rainbow for?
Well, because those kids watched it, didn't we, our generation?
Well, not everybody watched Rainbow.
Well, you might not. Surely you watched Rainbow, didn't you?
I weren't allowed.
What do you mean you weren't there to watch Rainbow?
Because it's on that, Devil's Channel, as my mum would say.
You what?
ITV. My mum says the only channel I should watch is the BBC because it has songs and prayers on it. And, that's why I weren't allowed to watch Rainbow.
So you were deprived by not watching Rainbow because there's songs and bloody praise then, were you?
Well, yeah, because my mum wanted to get her money's worth, didn't she?
What you mean by that?
Well, she's paying for a TV licence. Obviously, ITV is free, isn't it? Because of commercials, and that's why.
So, you had to watch all that religious stuff and all that lot then, did you?
Well, yeah, because back in our days, we had to sit down in front of the TV with our parents, or like you said, dinner time, you can watch children's programmes, didn't you? And obviously, you know, on the BBC, it was a different program. It was like, Play School.
You watch Play School?
Well, yeah.
Well, I'll go with, yeah, it was on the other side, but yeah.
And that's the education I got.
Well, the education we got from Rainbow is how deceitful adult films were, especially about straw dogs, when Zippy explained about what happened to Susan George, what happened to her character by having Jane explaining it with Rod, Jane and Freddy, explaining what happens in the movie. And the reason why we knew about that is, as you said, Captain Gorgeous, about commercials. Because obviously they always advertise the late night movie, especially at weekends.
But what are you getting at?
Well, there were adverts in between Rainbow, and obviously we were supposed to see in these images, and this is a good fine example to show you one of them.
Mad as Hell Weekend comes to an explosive end tonight with Dustin Hoffman in Straw Dogs. They rape his wife, and now he goes berserk. Come home to 11 for Straw Dogs. Tonight at 8, due to the adult control film, parental discretion is advised.
So are you actually understanding what I'm trying to get at now?
Well, not really.
Maybe the gist of it, maybe, because, there is that, point of view where it did give you the false illusion and a false perspective what that movie could have been about, because that's what they used to do, is like put different type of images and stuff on, and it's like you're doing to me and Captain Gorgeous when you're putting Emerald Fennell interviews, and she's very, very cagey to explain what this movie's about.
Well, she doesn't want to spoil it. Ah, but the point is, she's actually on a very serious subject, isn't she? And she says it's a very dark comedy. And we're left with our imagination, me and Captain Gorgeous. What's going to happen right now in this movie?
And I can't wait, because I've been anticipating to see what's going to happen.
Now I'm going to play the clips.
Oh, finally!
How long have I lived in the city? What are my hobbies?
What are you doing, Captain Pervert? What are you turning it off for?
It wasn't me. It was me. But why? Because you've been misleading us, haven't you? What you mean by that? Well, having the beginning title of Clockwork Orange, and then just on about Clockwork Orange when it isn't. Well, I might have done that on purpose, because to come out with my point, misleading it, because this is what this film's doing. And I don't forget, I know, because like we got educated back in the days when we were watching Rainbow and all that lot.
Oh, right. Are you going to put it back on now, Mr. Captain Know-It-All?
Well, yeah.
I think you should go.
But a second ago, you were determined for me to stay.
I've already seen that bit.
Alright, I wound it a little bit too far. Alright, come on, be patient.
You're pretty insistent, actually.
Well,
you're a nice guy.
That wasn't nice, turning it off on me.
Yeah, but if something's come into my mind, right? It reminds me of something, right? A trailer. It's something to do with Death Wish now. That's it. That's what I think it's reminding me of. I've never thought of it. I've been thinking the original. That's what I've been thinking of. But no, there's a remake of Death Wish, isn't there? With Bruce Willis and all that lot, isn't there? Oh yeah, there is, isn't there? But why now are you mentioning it now? Because I just thought of it now.
Well, I won't carry on watching the film.
Are you? I thought we had a connection, I guess.
A connection?
Why have you turned it off again, Thor?
Well, there's a connection. There's another remake, and oh, Straw Dogs as well, isn't there? Oh, yeah, there is, isn't there?
But, is that irrelevant?
Yeah, because it's just trailers. That's what it's bugging my little brain for. That, yeah, I'll play the trailer. Why?
Sway in the morning, say 4-5. We gotta talk about what's happening in Chicago. Oh. Everybody's watching this viral video of this guy in a hoodie. They're calling the Grim Reaper. He stopped the carjacking. Is he right for taking the law into his own hands? He's become a folk hero.
What about the shooter?
He looked like a white dude.
I love my family.
What is your emergency?
Excuse me, they're breaking into my house. Listen to here. No.
Failed to protect them.
Dad, where's Mom?
The men who did it are out there.
So there's nothing that you can do? Is that what you're saying?
If a man really wants to protect what's his,
he'll want to buy a gun.
He has to do it for himself.
We're closed, pal.
You killed my wife! Who else was there?
I don't know anything else.
I believe you, Joe.
You're not gonna kill me, little
jackass.
You got caught in some crossfire?
The ice cream man did it.
The ice cream man?
Can't get to school if it'll work for him.
Who are you? The last customer.
You're not a cop! Somebody has to do it!
You're caught, locked, and paid to work.
I'll see.
They called him a guardian angel.
He saved my life.
You look much better getting out socializing.
Not so much.
Well, whatever you're doing, keep it up.
Okay. Who
will.
You're determined to ruin this for me, aren't you? We're having a discussion that jumped my memory, thinking that's why that is reminding me of a trailer I've seen on YouTube. That's what I've been doing. But I think it's the remake of Straw Dogs. Yeah, put that on. No!
Home sweet home. Oh, Anna Cakes, ain't changed much.
Charlie, this is my husband, David.
Some desire.
So that guy, used to see him, right?
You jealous?
Cannot be denied.
Hey, Charlie, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife.
What happens when thy neighbor's wife covets you?
Some obsessions.
I want to come in.
Cannot be stopped. He's gone too far to turn back.
Right, can we get back to the movie?
Maybe one reason, not yet.
Why?
Because I think it could be the original trailer for Straw Dogs. Yeah, play that.
Why?
I'll give you one more chance. And if you don't clear out now, there'll be real trouble. I mean it.
This is David Sumner. All his life, he's been running away, turning his back on trouble, involvement, and confrontation. Until now.
5 men out there.
He took his wife and fled to an English country town.
There was once a time, Mrs. Sumner, when you were ready to beg me for it.
Take your hands off me.
Go on. Samuel, he thought he could find peace and refuge. Instead, he found that a man can't hide forever.
I care. This is where I live. I will not allow violence against this house.
Sam Peckinpah, who uncaged the Wild Bunch, now unleashes Dustin Hoffman in Straw Dogs.
Right, you played your trailer, now we can get back to watch the movie, can't we now?
Well, technically we can't, because I think it's time to end the show.
What?